Hello everyone, Brandon here, and today I'm at Weymouth Woods Sandhills Nature Preserve, here joined by Ranger Nancy.
Hey Brandon.
Today we're walking around and I'm noticing that these pine trees don't look like the ones I have at home.
Yeah, so you live in the Piedmont region, right? And you have probably more loblolly pine trees there. We have a lot of longleaf pine trees here, and they have a lot longer leaves. So the needles on a pine tree like this are the leaves, and the ones on longleaf can be up to about 18 inches long. That's really long. That's like a ruler and a half. And the cones are bigger too. So with the loblolly, the needles are gonna be a little bit smaller, the cones are gonna be a little bit smaller. So that's what kind of makes them really distinct looking from each other.
Cool, there is a cone here. Is this the seed itself? Well, what can you tell me about the life cycle?
Yeah, so the seeds are actually in the cone. At the base of each one of those little, those parts that pull back are called bracts, and at the base of each one of those is a seed. It actually all starts out with that pollen. If you live down here, you've probably seen those big clouds of pollen in the springtime. And when that pollen meets up with an undeveloped cone, the seeds or the cone can start to develop. And once those are fully developed, they'll drop the seeds in the fall. And once they germinate or start to, you know, actually grow, they'll start to put a taproot down in the ground. It's really important for them to get a taproot down in the ground. From there, they'll start to, there's a little tuft of what looks like grass over there behind you, but that's actually a baby pine tree. So that's kind of the next step. After they have germinated, they'll start to grow some needles and look like a little tuft of grass. Then they'll kind of hang out like that for several years, actually, until they've got enough nutrients, enough water stored up, till they can start to grow really fast. And they have this immense growth spurt. And then they can end up something like this, where they're growing 2 or 3 feet a year for the first couple years, until they, you know, kind of graduate to these different heights and start growing out limbs. And after about 30 or 40 years or so, they'll actually start to produce cones and seeds, and that starts the life cycle all over again.
So Ranger Nancy, I've noticed that around these young pine trees, there's a lot of char marks. Was there a fire here? Wouldn't the fire hurt the baby trees?
Longleaf pine trees are really well adapted to fire. For thousands of years, these plants got used to the climate here, which includes a lot of afternoon thunderstorms in the springtime and in the summertime. And sometimes those thunderstorms, you know, they produce lightning, which can produce, you know, wildfire if it strikes something. So over long periods of time, these trees have adapted to be able to cope with natural fires. So for example, this tree right here, this young one that's in this really fast growing stage right here, at the end of it, kind of hiding in between those needles is this little bud. And if that bud gets exposed to the heat of a fire, the whole tree could die. And so that's why it grows so fast during this stage, is so that it can get above the heat of any of those fires that would come through. Or like that little one behind you there, at that stage, you can't even really see that bud. It's not really developed yet. So if there is a fire at that point during, you know, that stage, it's not really gonna affect it.
Wow, that's pretty incredible. So there was a wildfire here and the tree survived?
So it wasn't actually a wildfire. We actually do prescribed burning here. So prescribed burning or controlled burning is a safe way to make sure that we get fire just in the places where we want them. So we don't want to wait around for lightning to strike, but we also don't want it to be something that's, you know, not controlled, because we have houses next to the park and we have the visitor center. So we want to make sure that it just stays right where we want it to, but also that the plants and the animals that live here need the fire that they're adapted to.
I've heard of prescribed fires at other parks, but so what about the big trees? How do they survive the fires?
Yeah, so the big trees, you can see the char marks on them. They have really thick bark, and their bark is really flaky too. So it's lots and lots of layers. So as those flames kind of pass by, you know, the really thick bark protects the living inside part of the tree with that, just that layer of kind of insulation. But also if the tree does catch on fire, like you can see some of them have, it's just that outer layer that burns, and then the flakiness kind of helps it. Then if you look out, you also notice that that there's not a lot of lower limbs on the trees, and that's to help protect the tree from flames climbing up into the tops of the trees. So it doesn't give it, you know, a ladder to climb up the tree. All it has to deal with is that flaky bark towards the bottom.
Well, so I'm noticing that the ground along the trails is very sandy. Do longleaf pines enjoy that sandy soil?
Actually, yeah, that's a great observation. So we are in the Sandhills here, and the longleaf pine trees are just a little bit better at some other trees than growing in these sandy soils that are very dry, they're very nutrient poor, and one of the big things that really helps them out with that is their really deep taproot. Longleaf can grow a taproot, that's like kind of the main part of the root that goes down in the ground, and they can grow one that's about 15 feet deep.
So that helps them anchor them down and absorb as much water as possible, but you mentioned poor nutrients. How do they deal with that?
Yeah, so actually there's a lot of interesting relationships that go on in longleaf, and one of those is that there are these mushrooms that form relationships with different trees. And there's a couple different ones that will form this symbiosis with the pine tree, where the underground part of the mushroom called the mycelium kind of intertangle with the roots of the trees. And it's called a mycorrhizal relationship. And the mushroom helps nutrient absorption for the pine. And then the pine tree actually gives back the sugars and stuff that it produces to the mushroom. So they kind of both win.
Are there any other interesting symbiotic relationships that the longleaf pine is a part of?
Oh, definitely, yeah. So to build on that one, just between the mushroom and the pine tree, one of the neat animals that live here, fox squirrels, one of my favorites. Fox squirrels will actually eat the mushrooms and that are helping out these pine trees, that when it passes through their body, they spread the spores around, which actually then helps go to more pine trees. And then, of course, that helps the pine trees grow, and then the pine trees, you know, can keep producing pine cones and keep going, and then those pine cones will actually also produce a second food source for the squirrel, which are the seeds in the pine cones. They're really, you know, high calorie content, lots of energy for the squirrels, so everybody kind of wins in that situation.
So, Ranger Nancy, thank you for telling me all about the longleaf pines, and I think I learned a lot of really cool things about life cycles and symbiotic relationships.
Yeah, you're welcome. Glad to have you here, and I encourage you, when you head home, look for these types of symbiotic relationships and interactions just with things in your own neighborhood too. You can find really cool stuff everywhere.